Let's revisit the joint blade problem. We have a pressure on the blade and fixed boundary conditions at the center. We know that the reaction force from the fixed boundary condition will balance out the external load. This is called global force balance. In solid mechanics, to find deformation, stress, and strain of a body, instead of looking at the global force balance, we need to solve the local internal force balance. Solving the local force balance equilibrium will lead us to the distortion of a body. And the global force balance is a consequence that we need to verify after the problem is solved. The local equilibrium is derived from the internal force balance on the infinitesimal cube. Let's have a look at the load condition on the infinitesimal cube. There are six surfaces on the cube. We denote stresses on different surfaces by the surface ID 1 to 6. On each surface, we can find forces by multiplying the stress components by the surface area. For example, on face 1, force created by sigma xx is sigma xx times the area, and the area is dimension delta z times delta y. Or, for force created by sigma yx on surface 1, the force is simply sigma yx times delta y times delta z. Same thing for all the forces on the six surfaces. Basically, each surface has three forces. Besides the surface load, the cube might also suffer from body force. For example, gravity, electric fields, or magnet fields. Body force is proportional to the volume of the cube. If the body force density is denoted by B, the body force can be simply written as B times the volume of the cube. Now, let's discuss the relationship between the stress components on different surfaces. Between the six surfaces on the cube, there are three parallel pairs: surface 1 and 2, surface 3 and 4, and surface 5 and 6. Let's have a look of surface 1 and 2. They both have sigma xx. What's the relationship between these two? Along dimension x, the stress value is changing, and we record such difference by the rate of change of stress in x direction. So, in the relationship equation of the two stress value, this term, partial derivative of sigma xx in x dimension, is the rate of change of sigma xx in x direction. Same thing for sigma yx and sigma zx on surface 1 and 2. We use rate of change of sigma yx and sigma zx to relate them. And such relationship can be extended to surface pairs 3 and 4 and surface 5 and 6. With the relationship between surface forces clarified, let's sum up forces in x, y, and z direction. So what are the forces in x direction on this cube? On surface 1 and 2, there are forces on x direction from sigma xx. Let's sum them up and times the area. Surface 1 and 2 share the same area value. On surface 3 and 4, there are forces on x direction from sigma xy. On surface 5 and 6, there are forces on x direction from sigma xz. Note that the first index of the stress components tell us the direction of the stress components. Besides, we also need to include the body force in x direction here. If we substitute the relationship between stresses on surface pairs as we discussed before, the force balance in the x direction will become to be a much more concise format as shown here. Doing summation on force in y and z direction will lead to similar results. And these three equations are the local equilibrium we're looking for. We call the first three items of these three expressions the divergence of a tensor. If we write these equations by tensor and vector format instead of individual components, the local equilibrium can be even more concise as represented by this single equation. Equilibrium is the center of mechanical problems. Besides equilibrium, the statum of a solid mechanical problem also needs the description of deformation, materials model, and boundary conditions. Let's try to solve a very simple 1D problem manually and see how the mentioned information is used. Say we have a one-dimensional bar with length L. One end of it is fixed and the other end is under pressure P. For the material, it's a simple linear material with Young's modulus E and density rho. And here, what we want to solve is the deformation everywhere over the bar. First of all, we need to describe the problem mathematically. So what we're looking for is a deformation function ux such that the local equilibrium is satisfied for all x from 0 to length L on the bar. With given boundary conditions that u0 equals to 0 because it's fixed and stress at the bottom and sigma L equals to P. And here is the local equilibrium. We can see that stress is related to strength by material model and strength is related to deformation, which is our unknown. In 1D space, the divergence and gradient can be simplified to the derivative with respect to x. After substituting the material model and deformation description to the equilibrium, the problem actually can be hand calculated. If we do an integral to this differential equation, we need to add a constant c1 to the end. Doing another integration, we will have the expression of the deformation u, but we need to add another unknown constant c2. So, if we find c1 and c2, the problem is solved. But how to find them? They are decided by boundary conditions. Boundary conditions tell us that sigma L equals to P and u0 equals to 0. By using these two equations, we can find c1 and c2. Let's assume the length, density, and pressure are unitless 1 in this problem. Here, the deformation is calculated to be a quadratic function with respect to x. If you want to know the deformation at any location on the bar, just substitute the x value into this expression, you'll find the deformation. This 1D linear problem we just solved probably is the simplest problem in solid mechanics. For realistic mechanical problem, solving the local equilibrium directly is almost impossible. We cannot find continuous equations to represent deformation for complex problems. The alternative way to solve the problem is to use a numerical method to find an approximate solution. And the finite element method is the most widely used numerical method for solid mechanics. Instead of looking for a continuous solution over the domain, finite element method divides the domain into elements and find a piecewise solution on these elements. In following series of courses, finite element method will be discussed in detail.